skip now. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Cool. Okay. So welcome everybody to our fifth visiting artist lecture in our 7-week series for our 8-week summer intensive for MFA, Low-Res, and Digital Studies. Most of you guys know me. I'm interim program chair Laura Hughes, and we're really excited to be joined by Shana Moulton tonight. Shana will be talking about her work and showing some videos, and then following that we'll have a little Q&A session. I'm going to now turn the floor over to third year candidate Christina Smiros, who's going to introduce Shana. So thank you guys for coming.
Shana Moulton lives and works near Yosemite, California. Over the past 15 years, she has been developing her ongoing video performance series, Whispering Pines, in which she plays the role of Cynthia, both a fictional figure and the artist's alter ego. A new take on the operatic form of the monodrama, or mad scene, the agoraphobic and hypochondriac Cynthia struggles with her domestic interior, filled with the kitschy new age objects, turning to nature to discover that her life is boundless and full of magic. Drawing on the artist's own biography for narrative inspiration, Moulton says, "I am presenting my own struggle, my own paranoia or neurosis, with this personal fallible point of view." Moulton has had solo exhibitions or performances at the New Museum, SFMOMA, MoMA P.S.1, Performa 2009, The Kitchen, Electronic Arts Intermix, in art in general, the Andy Warhol Museum, the Migros Museum in Zurich, and the Times Museum in Guangzhou. She is a featured artist in the Electronic Arts Intermix and Art 21.
Thank you, Christina. That was great. You said it all. And thanks so much to Aaron and Laura for bringing me out here. It's wonderful to be in Portland, and thank you all for coming. I want to mention how much I am enjoying the collection of library books that students in the program selected for me. They're in my room, and it's so nice to be around a library, for one thing, an art library in particular, after being in Oakhurst for the past couple of years, so it's exciting, and I'm, taking note of these books for future reference. But I had to start with the David Lynch biography since I'm, starting the new series. But they're all really great, thank you. So today I have a lot of video to show, and I'm starting from the very beginning of this body of work, which is 2001. Because it's really the only way I know how to explain the work or to contextualize the current work is by explaining how it began. And I hope that's helpful for people in the program since it did begin in grad school. And graduate school was really important for me in figuring out how to continue as an artist, make that a lifelong career. And mainly because I figured out how to, continue to be excited about making work and to enjoy, making work and to have ideas that made me laugh out loud. And that's how I knew I was on the right track. I started out, I went to Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh, and I had double majored in art and anthropology as an undergrad, and I had done some performance, but I hadn't really found my way yet. So I started making these dresses with medical devices embedded in the fabric. I had also, before grad school, had a job at a dot-com in San Francisco, and I got carpal tunnel and was going through a lot of physical therapy, and somehow saw a lot of the physical therapy had to do with posture, and that was sort of the key to solving the carpal tunnel problem, was getting better posture. And I thought a lot about my anthropology studies because, for me, one of the reasons I majored in anthropology was because I was interested in how and why we became bipedal and what that had to do with consciousness. So these were sort of my investigation, or, you know, had to do with my interest in that. And also just me being a hypochondriac. So that those were some neck brace dresses. This is a blood pressure tester dress and a walker dress. And then a hemorrhoid pillow dress. And I originally thought of them as sculptures. And then I decided to try taking photographs in them since I made them for my size. But then an advisor posed a question, what kind of person would need to wear these dresses? And so that's where my alter ego, Cynthia, initially came from. So I will show you the very first video I made with Cynthia. It's only 2 minutes. And it's from 2001, or two, I don't remember. Teach myself After Effects, and that really opened up this whole springboard for me. So in the next video, this is Whispering Pines 2, the decor in my house starts to become like other characters in the narrative. The other impetus for making this into a series, besides being such a big Twin Peaks fan, was a couple of different artist collectives around the time that were accepting submissions to their websites. And this is before YouTube. There was one called Zero TV based in Milwaukee that had a couple of different web-based art video series. One was called Wizards, and the other one was called Milwaukee, and those were really inspiring and fantastic. And then I was going to graduate school with a member of a collective called Paper Rad, and their approach to web-based animations and videos was exciting to me because I didn't know how else I would put work into the world. I didn't know about galleries or representation, or I had no idea how I would ever access that, and I thought putting my work on the internet would be the best way to do that. This is Whispering Pines 3, and I made this at Skowhegan. Do you guys all know about, I mean, you can't go if you're in a summer MFA program, but I highly recommend applying and applying, you know, over and over until you get in, which is what I did. And a friend of mine applied 12 times until he got in. So it was really, well, for me, it made a big difference for me just because I met so many great artists that helped me. And it also led to me moving to New York for about 8 years. And this particular video, I enter my dream world through this dream catcher that's shaped to fit into my neck brace. And then this is from 2007. This is a photo of my house. I moved back to Oakhurst for about 6 months after living in Amsterdam for 2 years. I went to a program called the Ateliers there, which was a kind of a post-grad program. And another place I recommend if you're interested in living in Europe and working and getting a small stipend in an amazing studio space. So I came back and I stayed with my parents, and I wanted to use my mom's hand collection. So I made this video called Whispering Pines 4, and I like to show an excerpt from this one. This is also inspired by an Avon reflexology kit that my aunt gave me for Christmas. And my mom plays a sort of witch doctor, healer, Avon lady. And it starts, I'm in search of someone to help with my carpal tunnel, and I find her in the woods.
It's not my front right. It's how much is needed. It's access to all that is. Access to all that ever was. And access to all that will ever be. My awareness is capable of transcending the physical. Capable of transcending any limits imposed by my waking physical reality. I have had many experiences that prove this to me beyond a shadow of a doubt. Every night, my physical body goes to sleep, yet I dream. I exist in this dream realm as much as I exist in my waking world. I am more than my physical body. I am endless, limitless, unbounded, unrestrained, and unrestricted.
Look in the mirror.
Free to access the infinite. Open to my true dynamic nature, constantly changing and shifting, continually adapting and evolving. Perpetually expanding and transcending, fully present, fully conscious, fully aware in the present moment, I am more than my physical body.
Eventually I dissolve into the land from Donald in Math Magic Land, which was a 1959 animation by Disney that explains the occult side of mathematics. Um, And then at this point, I moved to New York, but I came back to Oakhurst for a while and took a road trip with my parents to Taos, New Mexico, and Sedona, Arizona. And when we were there, I filmed myself walking around different sites in those locations. And I didn't know what kind of video I would make with these sites. So I ended up later on deciding to connect this sort of pilgrimage I'm making to a search for the site of the Antiques Roadshow. And there's an episode where someone has a Zuni pot evaluated for $30,000 to $40,000. And that's where this video starts, is my alter ego seeing this. And then it was also connected to my parents having watched an episode about some pottery from the North Dakota School of Mines that they happened to have, and then recognizing it on the show and then selling it for a few $1,000s. So this excerpt I'll show starts from the moment I find the Antiques Roadshow site after having walked through... after having walked through these sites, and I also don't have any legs, and so it's sort of this pilgrimage for healing as well as finding the Antiques Roadshow. These are some artifacts I had in my house.
So, do you have any idea of what they are?
Native American? Maybe Zuni?
Okay, so, what we have here are some walking sticks, resembling Zuni staffs, but made with modern massage tools. And this pot, you can see this Avon logo, and inside, it's actually a foot bath.
So, it's not real?
If this were a real Zuni pot, it would be worth $30,000 to $40,000. But since it's just a foot massager that Avon made 15 years ago, it's worth about $20.
Thank you. particular video, I also like to show an excerpt from a video that I didn't name Whispering Pines, but still consider part of that body of work. And actually, after this, I stopped calling them Whispering Pines, but just because I get excited about titles, and in this case, it was learning of a book by Philip K. Dick, the science fiction writer, called The Galactic Pot Healer, and instantly having an idea for a narrative based just on hearing the title. And then I read the book, and I did draw a little bit from the actual narrative of the book, but it's mostly just this idea directly from hearing the title. And it's sort of the inverse of the previous video. Shows the pot. The pot healer puts a pot in the microwave, which fires it, and then it comes out being the same pot that I've broken in the beginning, this sort of blue-colored pot. And it was with that video and Whispering Pines 9, this Antiques Roadshow video, where I started to get opportunities to make installations to show the videos in, and when I can, that's my preferred way of showing the work, just because I feel like it gives the viewer the chance to have a tactile relationship with the work, and for me to create an environment to see it in, rather than just, a black box. I also do like to show a lot of the videos together in a sort of screening format and then come out and perform with a video. This is the beginning of the Galactic Popular. And that's actually from the book. This the main character is finding messages in his medicine cabinet for how to locate this Popular in some other galaxy. And this is how I installed the first version of the galactic pot healer, and I made this sculpture with the healer healing pots and the sorted assembly line fashion with the healed pots going upstairs. And that also ends up in a performance and live performance is probably half of my practice too, and I tend not to love the documentation of performance, so I don't end up showing it a lot. But I thought maybe I would show you all a performance background video, so you can see how I incorporated another piece called Restless Leg Saga, which is a video, a narrative where these sort of pharmaceutical logos come to life and start dancing around, and then I end up taking a medicine called Ion A, which I discovered in a Swiss drugstore. And this medicine was discovered by an artist called Emma Coons, who makes these, or who used to make these grid-based drawings in the, I guess, 30s, 40s, 50s. And she considered these grid-based drawings more like healing tools than art. And she also found this Ion A in a mine near Zurich. And you can visit the mine and get the healing vibes from this mineral in the mine. And you can also, there's a nearby museum of her art. And I was stunned that you could still buy this Ion A in the drugstores there. So that, you'll see how that gets incorporated into the performance background video. And I'll just sort of demonstrate what a performance would be like. This is, it starts out with this mousing, and I come out with a medicine ball, Pilates ball, and sort of start rolling that along with the mousing. And then it goes into the section with the pharmaceutical.
Overactive nerves that cause chronic widespread pain. Lyrica is believed to calm these nerves.
Thank you.
Cynthia. This particular performance ended up, usually the performances end up becoming inspired by the video, and I take pieces from the video and then create a performance from that. But this particular performance was both ways and ended up then becoming the basis for Mind Place Thought Stream, which is from 2014 and is framed by Cynthia attempting to cure her IBS, irritable bowel syndrome, with biofeedback. And that sort of becomes a jumping point for her into this other alternate reality. And I'll show that entire video. But first I'll show a few more pictures of performances. This is from Decorations of the Mind and is a video version of a, or video installation version of a live performance. And then at the end of this performance, after unsuccessfully attempting to see the 3D image of a 3D magic eye poster, she it speaks to her and it explains how to see its image. And she is so excited by what she sees, she climbs through the poster and joins the other fantasy creatures. And in the first version of this performance, it was fantasy creatures that, you know, she sees in the poster that you typically find in one, like dolphins or unicorns. And in the second version, it's recently extinct animals that she joins. So this is a couple of other shots of me interacting with projection and performance. This is from a performance called Body Plus Mind. No, wait, Body Divided by Mind Plus 7 Equals Spirit. And the finale is a sort of moment taken from the horror movie Carrie, where she's covered in pig's blood, and I used Pepto-Bismol instead. And then I'll show you an excerpt from one of my longest performances. It was a collaboration with a composer, Nick Hallett, and I brought it here to Portland in either 2011 or 12 to the TVA festival. And it's a three-channel interaction, and the original version that we premiered at the kitchen had live interactive with a camera that recognized my movement, and then, you know, the video reacted accordingly. And the trailer I have for that is from that first version, so you can see the actual interactivity there. And every other version we did since has changed and is a faked interactivity. the narrative of that particular performance is based on Cynthia wanting to emulate the activist Julia Butterfly Hill, who you might remember from the late 90s climbing an old growth giant sequoia tree in Northern California and staying in it for 2 years until they guaranteed it wouldn't be logged. And when that happened, I was an undergrad still, and that's the kind of thing I imagined I would be doing, and was excited to learn, you know, about performance artists that had done sort of absurd durational things, like Turching Shea in the 60s or 70s, who did several year-long performances. He tied himself to the artist, Linda Montano, and collaborated in one where they were tied to each other by an 8-foot rope, and they stayed that way for a year. And another year-long performance, I believe he was in a bird cage. And then in another one, he checked in on the hour, every hour for a year. So I was excited by the idea that maybe something like what Julia Butterfly Hill did could be seen in that tradition of durational performance. But I ended up doing much more surrealist things in my work, and I do still hope that I can find a way to bring that kind of activism into my work someday. So we'll see. Now that I'm living in Yosemite, there might be more opportunities for that. And with this particular performance, Nick and I got a creative capital grant to turn it into a web-based opera, so we're still working on that, and that's set to premiere sometime at the end of this year, beginning of next. And the idea was that we would transform the opera into video episodes that you could view online, and then perhaps have some other apps or internet-based things related to that. And then we're part of that grant we're using to create another evening-length opera that is sort of a part two to this episode, Whispering Pines 11. going back to Mindfest Thought Stream, this is how I installed that video in the Yerba Buena Center for the Arts in 2015. And I had a sort of inner sanctum with the projection, and I think it was a 4 or 5 channel projection inside, and then outer waiting room area, and users could try the biofeedback devices that I use in the video. So I'll go ahead and show that full video now. It's about 11 minutes. What?
and eat Activia.
Surrender, I said goodbye to my life, and my mind was now suspended between two very opposite planes of reality. I could not identify the position of my body in space. I felt enormous and expansive, like a genie just liberated from her bottle. And my spirit soared free like a great whale gliding through a sea of silent euphoria. Nirvana. I found nirvana. And I remember thinking, there's no way I would ever be able to squeeze the enormousness of myself back inside this tiny little body. And I pictured a world filled with beautiful, peaceful, compassionate, loving people who knew that they could come to this space at any time, and that they could purposely choose to step to the right of their left hemispheres and find this peace. And then I realized what a tremendous gift this experience could be. What a stroke of insight this could be to how we live our lives. And it motivated me to recover. It took me 8 years to completely recover. So, who are we? We are the life force power of the universe. I believe that the more time we spend choosing to run the deep inner peace circuitry of our right hemispheres, the more peace we will project into the world, and the more peaceful our planet will be. And I thought that was an idea worth spreading.
This pops the picture puzzle pattern door. And I'm now whizzing through this sucker like if it was nothing. I'm flying through it. But now I know what the picture puzzle pattern door is. The picture puzzle pattern door is the farthest reaches of your humanity. This is the doorway into what defines you as a human being. When you go past that, you stop being human to a degree. And the further you get past this point, the further away you go from being a human being. But right here, this picture puzzle pattern door is everything. It's everything. It's what defines you as a human being. This picture puzzle pattern door is you.
gloves are incredible. Oh my gosh!
Cynthia, this alter ego, that it could be a sort of trap, but I decided that she was just very liberating for me, you know, as a framework to make work within. And every time I, you know, would try to think of a new piece, I needed her to execute the idea. So I've just decided to allow her to continue to exist as long as she supplies these ideas. And, I mean, she really is just me with a wig. It's not really a separate character with a different, you know, with a different background. It's really me, or who I imagined I would be when I was a kid, or maybe who I would be if I had gone to art school. So, so it's, you know, she's a wig, really, and a way for me to have a little distance from myself, but it's just me. And I'll just finish showing you guys a couple pictures of what I've worked on more recently. This is an installation in Paris at the Palais de Tokyo. And it also had a sort of inner video sanctum where I showed a video based on Cynthia or my relation or what's the word? Sympathy for this woman named Marcia Moore, who back in the 70s was using ketamine as a sort of spiritual tool before they realized how dangerous it was. And she wrote an amazing book about her spiritual development through ketamine, but then right after the book was published, was found, disappeared, and then was found dead 2 years later. But her insights through ketamine are really very creative and surreal and inspiring. There was some audio from the previous video that is also inspiring to me and related, and it's from a documentary called The Spirit Molecule, where they interview people who were part of a research study who had taken DMT in a hospital. And so the picture puzzle pattern door is the response someone had from a DMT trip. Lately I found people's descriptions of these psychedelic experiences really inspiring. I can sort of live through those descriptions. And I think Cynthia does too. And then this is an installation called Every Cell Has a Bell, which is a quote from that book, where a mannequin modeled on Cynthia is climbing from the sort of safer domestic space to the more sort of magic-based domestic space. And then this is what I'm working on at the moment. For the solstice, I've designed a van, and I'll show a video inside that van. And this will take place in Jackson Hole, and I'll go over there a week before the solstice and film myself driving around in this van, and it will also be an opportunity for me to learn how to drive through making a video, which I think that's the only way I'll drive, is if I need to make art with that. So hopefully Cynthia will help me successfully learn to drive in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, during the solstice. I guess that's it then. If you guys have any questions, I'd love to answer any thoughts you have. Would be great. Otherwise, thank you for coming. More the wig than me. I've tried driving a few times, and I have a real phobia of driving. So I'm hoping that by having to make art with it and having, you know, setting up a camera, that I'll be able to get into the zone and defeat that fear. And you know, I've been able to explore things that I'm uncomfortable with through making these videos, so I don't know if it will work with driving, but I've done it with bugs, and you know, and these sort of spiritual questions that, or bodily questions. So yeah, perhaps Cynthia will help me learn how to drive. We'll see.
Louise Hay. But it's like right in there with
fire. Oh, okay. Wait, what is it called again?
I think it's You Can Heal Your Body, Heal Your Mind.
I haven't read that, but it sounds very much like... Yeah. No, it's something that I'll have to check out. Came together was that I needed a reason for this pot to be valuable besides it having, you know, a supposed monetary or cultural or historical value, which is what she thought it would have with, you know, bringing it to the Antiques Roadshow. And at the same time, there was a story in the press about the movie company that... what's that director who did the Hobbit movie and the Lord of the Rings movies? Yeah. Peter Jackson. His movie company made a mermaid tail for a woman who didn't have legs. And so that my idea came sort of from that story, that this pot would, instead of, you know, having this other kind of value, would give her the legs she had been missing all along. So that's how that came around. So I had to go back to all of these shots, you know, of me walking around and erase my legs frame by frame, which was, you know, a good challenge.
You have mentioned a number of ways that you incorporate research into the way that you do this, but I'm interested in, your ideas are so surreal that you're obviously grounding it in real things. I'm wondering where the ideas start. Like, do they start with sort of tangible things in the world and then turn surreal? Imaginations and then you tie them into your world.
they start with tangible objects. And, you know, I would have to go, you know, video by video, but the one I think about the most is the reflexology kit my aunt gave me. And that was like, that led to that whole video. But it was a combination of that and my mom's hand collection, you know, and then wanting to make something about my carpal tunnel that brought those together. And also, you know, the found footage and the found audio is also usually a springboard for the ideas. And then I think a lot of the surreal narrative or the fun for me in making and drawing those things together is how to connect them. You know, how do I connect Donald in Math Magic Land to Avon Reflexology Kit, and then that's how I come up with the narratives. And yeah, but it, you know, I guess it depends. The other video I was just describing was mainly inspired by quotes from this woman on her spiritual ketamine trips. So it depends, but yeah, it's usually concrete things, and a lot of times it's gifts or shopping. Sky Mall used to be a big source for me. Sad that it's gone. Thrift stores, you know, and that was finding a 3D Magic Eye poster at a garage sale was a big revelation, because that was something that was so striking to me as a teenager. You know, I just thought, wow. When I first saw one, I was blown away. And so then 10 years later to find one at a garage sale was like a real sort of gut feeling that I had to make something, you know. And then it was funny to later see that there was a Seinfeld episode about that too. And that's happened a couple times. There's another Seinfeld episode that is really, anyways. So, yeah.
Following on that, I'm just curious about your process overall.
It's a combination of both. The first couple videos I made were storyboarded them because my advisor made me. And I still have those storyboards. They're pretty cute, you know, they're hand-drawn. And I put a lot of time into those. But I don't do that now, and I don't really script things, but I have, for each shot, I know exactly what I'm gonna do, because, and especially when it comes to some of the special effects like green screening or combination green screen, I have that all worked out in my head so that I can then, you know, make the special effect happen. And that's, you know, since learning After Effects, that's been the most fun for me. There's a video I didn't show where I climb a ladder that grows out of a vase and climb this ladder into the ceiling. And working out how to do that was like, you know, a real challenge and a success for me, you know, to get myself to climb this flower-based ladder. So it's not really scripted, but I know exactly what I'm going to do for each shot. Not yet, although it was, you know, living in Germany was eye-opening, because it was really not okay to make that kind of work in Germany. My students weren't allowed to make work like, you know, they couldn't use found music in that way. It totally wasn't allowed there. And it's, you know, here, I mean, it's not really, you know, in some cases it's okay if you look at it from certain perspectives, but there, you know, I was asked by Adult Swim to show some videos, but we were having a hard time choosing something that I could show on that. But there's another case where I didn't show this video. It's called Whispering Pines 5, and it in it Cynthia's reading this book called the Feel Good Handbook, and it's very, you know, I show the cover, and the daughter of the author saw the video at a film festival. But she really, she loved it, and she showed her dad, or I sent him a copy of the video, and then he sent me a copy of his new book. So in that case, it worked out well. But yeah, it's, especially with the music, I try to be very specific about what I get, and in some cases, if I can, I'll get permission. In Whispering Pines 4, I didn't play the end, but I use a song called Parallelograms by Linda Perhax, and I got permission from her to use that song. But with the music that's really commercial and is from a commercial, I don't feel like I need permission because it's already in a TV commercial. You know, it's using, they're selling things with it, so, but that's the kind of thing I could probably get the most in trouble with, too. But so far, so good.
I've noticed that a lot of people have health problems in grad school, and I was wondering if you had any health tips.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, I have so many. I mean, I probably have more health problems since grad school. Yoga. I'm trying to get a lot of iron lately. I'm having an iron issue, so I think. I'm sure it's easy to ignore things like iron in your diet when you're in grad school. There's so many things that I wished I'd started back then, like Tai Chi, yoga, acai bowls, all of these things. I think in the beginning, if taken that along with, alternative spiritualities. For me, I sort of conflate those two. And because I'm skeptical of both, but I don't think I've ever been totally, I'd never be totally dismissive of either. I was maybe a little bit more ironic in my approach to them when I started with this. And I think I'm less ironic with it, although still skeptical. But the more I make work about these things, the more it becomes a part of my lifestyle too. I don't like dogma, but I do like piecing together a way of living through these different things. And so I've probably also become more and more of a hypochondriac though. So it's really like, if I had a lot of money, I would spend it on all alternative healing, every alternative healing thing. And health food thing I could get my hands on. So, yeah.
Have you considered or thought about having another alter ego besides Cynthia?
I've considered it, but I haven't had that inspiration yet. And if I did, I would embrace it. But I haven't, and people have, encouraged me to think of other characters. There's variations of Cynthia with different wigs and there's only been variations of Cynthia. I haven't really come up with another character yet. I guess that's one more.
Related to the music question, I mean, there's a lot of sound in the video, the same original or your mix. Is there any way or any site that we can find any music at?
Oh, well, no, I don't have a site. I mean, some of the music is made by some collaborators, Nick Hallett. Okay. Jacob Chiacci, who's from Paper Rad, maybe if anyone knows him, he was in Whispering Pines 9, and he's made music for my work. Otherwise, it's mainly Enya, remixes of Enya, Deep Forest, and Enigma. Art of Noise, too. Cool. Well, thanks for your questions. Great.
Before you guys run away, just a couple of announcements. So next week we're going to have two talks. We're going to have Tuesday lunchtime, 11:30 in Bridge Lab with Bobby Woods, Portland-based artist. And then we're going to have our evening Wednesday lecture in here, same time, same place, with Mark Verabayoff from LA, whose project is going to be Our lecture is going to be partly performative, involving a pair of leather boots strapped to speakers, so it should be pretty interesting. And then also two other things. Second-year student Richard Boswell has an exhibition up right now at the Lodge at Allied Works Architecture in Southwest till the end of the month. And stay tuned for notices of our thesis exhibition and first and second-year shows that are coming up. So thank you, guys. Thank you, Shana.